foundations of amateur radio. It's hard to imagine today, but there was a time when there was no such thing as either the 80-metre or the 20-metre amateur band, let alone 2 metres or 70 centimetres. Picture this. It's the Roaring Twenties. The 1920s, that is. Among a jazz age burst of economic prosperity, modern technology such as automobiles, moving pictures, social and cultural dynamism, the peak of Art Deco, we're also in the middle of a radio boom, where the world is going crazy buying radios as fast as they can be constructed. There are hundreds of licensed broadcasters. The bands are getting crowded. Radio amateurs have been banned from the lucrative radio spectrum above 200 metres, and can only play in the useless shortwaves, using frequencies greater than 1500 kHz. And play they did. On the 2nd of May 1925, amateurs proved they could communicate with any part of the world at any time of the day or night, when Ernest J. Simmonds, Golf 2 Oscar Delta, and Charles Maclurcan Alpha 2 Charlie Mike made a daylight contact between Meadowlea, Gerrards Cross, Buckinghamshire, England, and Strathfield, Sydney, New South Wales, Australia, on what we now call the 20-metre band. This contact occurred not once, but regularly, for several days, using 100 watts. To give you a sense of just how big news of this feat was, on the second scheduled contact, the Prime Minister of Australia, Stanley Bruce, sent a message to England's Prime Minister, Stanley Baldwin. On occasion of this achievement, Australia sends greetings. If you recall, the IARU, the International Amateur Radio Union, was a fortnight old at this point. Less than a year later, contact was made using voice. Between the banning of radio amateurs from frequencies below 1500 kHz at the London International Radio Telegraph Conference in 1912 and the Washington International Radio Telegraph Conference in 1927, the world had irrevocably changed. In 1912, the discussion was almost all about ship-to-shore communication. By 1927, the world had tube transmitters, amplitude voice modulation, higher frequencies, and what the 1993 IARU President Richard Baldwin Whiskey One Romeo Uniform calls literally an explosion in the use of the radio frequency spectrum. In 1927, individual countries were beginning to control the use of spectrum, but there was no universal coordination, no international radio regulation, and as we all know, radio waves don't stop at the border. Richard Whiskey One Romeo Uniform, writing in 1993, says, quote, "In retrospect, the Washington Conference of 1927 was a remarkable effort. It created the framework of international radio regulation that exists even today. It had to recognize and provide for a multitude of radio services, including the amateur service. It was at this conference that amateur radio was, for the first time, internationally recognized and defined. Bands of harmonically related frequencies were allocated to the various radio services, including the amateur service." End quote. While the IARU was 2 years old, it really hadn't represented amateur radio on the international stage. Until now. The 1927 conference defined an amateur as a duly authorized person interested in radio electric practice with a purely personal aim and without pecuniary interest. The harmonically related frequencies that were allocated to the amateur service are recognizable today. I'll use current band names to give you some context. 1715 kHz to 2 MHz or 160 metres. 3.5 to 4 MHz or 80 metres. 7 to 7.3 MHz or 40 metres. 14 to 14.4 MHz or 20 metres. 28 to 30 MHz or 10 metres. And 56 to 60 MHz or 6 metres. Of those, the 20 metre and 80 metre bands were exclusive to amateurs. The 10 metre and 6 metre bands were shared with experimenters, and the 160 metre and 80 metre bands were shared with fixed and mobile services. You'll notice the absence of bands we use today. the 2 metre and 70 centimetre bands, 15 metres, and the so-called WARC bands, to name a few. The final ratified document goes into great detail about the requirements, the restrictions, how to deal with interference, how to allocate frequencies, and numerous other provisions, many of which will look familiar almost 100 years later if you've ever looked at the rules and regulations under which you operate as a licensed amateur today. There were various radio amateurs at the 1927 conference, but as Richard Whiskey One Romeo Uniform puts it, quote, "Much of the credit for the success of amateur radio at that conference has to go to two representatives of ARRL, Hiram Percy Maxim, president of ARRL, and Kenneth B. Warner, secretary and general manager of ARRL." End quote. While Richard points to their roles in the ARRL, you might recall that Hiram was elected international president of the IARU, and Kenneth its international secretary-treasurer. Whichever way you look at it, whichever organisation you credit, today we have amateur bands thanks to those efforts made nearly a century ago. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima, Alpha Bravo.